Good evening, everyone. Welcome on this wet and windy night to the November 19th meeting of the Sammamish City Council. We have a regular meeting this evening. The agenda looks reasonably short, so with some crossing of our fingers, we might be able to get out of here reasonably quickly. Madam City Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mayor Tom O'Dell.
Here.
Deputy Mayor John James.
Here.
Councilmember John Curley. Councilmember Don Jaren.
Here.
Councilmember Romero Valderrama.
Present.
Councilmember Tom Vance.
Here.
Councilmember Nancy Whitten.
Here.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor.
Councilmember Jaren, I'm sorry.
I'd like to move to excuse Councilmember Curley for personal reasons.
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to excuse Councilmember Curley for personal reasons. Any discussion on the issue? Councilmember Whitten.
I have seconded this motion and will probably vote for it, but unless I hear some reason not to. But I do like to, this brings to our attention with maybe having a discussion on taking attendance at council sessions, council study sessions, and maybe having some more of a policy that we develop in terms of attendance and when it would be correct to excuse someone and when it would not.
Okay. Other comments? From the standpoint of the chair, I will vote to excuse Councilmember Curley this evening, but we all take this office with a full knowledge that we're chosen for a reason. And if circumstances dictate that we can't be here, we need to let people know well ahead of time. And we also need to make every effort to be here as much as possible. If we are not here, it does hinder the work of the council. And in fact, under certain circumstances, the council may not be able to function should we fail to have a quorum. So from that standpoint, I believe that as we go through our tenure on the council, if our circumstances change, we need to be in a position to evaluate that and act accordingly. So yes, Councilmember Whitten.
It's not just having a quorum. It's that on certain measures, such as the budget or other financial spending measures, we can't pass them without not just a quorum, but a majority of four.
Right.
And if we have some disagreements on the budget, for example, two members and there's a third one absent, a budget may not get passed. That's really critical, and that was discussed as a possibility tonight. And so being here is important for more than just having the quorum. It's also for getting our work to pass.
Absolutely. We've had two incidents recently on two separate meetings where we were unable to reach a decision on an issue. So it's not something that should be taken lightly. Any further comments? So I'll call the question. All in favor of excusing Councilmember Curley, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay. By our vote of 6-0, Councilmember Curley is excused. And going back to Councilmember Whitten's comment earlier about taking attendance at study sessions, I would be in favor of that as well.
Can I make a motion to that effect?
Sure. We'll schedule it. I mean, that's
okay.
That's
schedule
fine.
It. Thank you.
We don't need to make a motion on that one. We'll
okay.
Schedule it.
So, at this point, I'm going to ask us to rise for the Pledge of the Allegiance, and we have a young man who is wearing a scout uniform who I'll call upon to lead us in the pledge. Just turn around, sir. Right there.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands,
one nation,
under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. So, may I have a motion for approval of the agenda?
So moved.
Been moved and seconded to approve the agenda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. By our vote of 6-0, the agenda is approved. We appeared not to have student liaison reports this evening.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Councilmember.
I'd like to report for the students on the.
You would?
Yes.
Well, you have to go down there then.
You have to brush your.
I can't report on the academics, I don't know that, but I do read the newspaper, the sports section, and the Skyline girls soccer team won the state championship. And the Skyline boys football team is in the semifinals against Camas, and they're playing in the Tacoma Dome this Saturday at 1:00. And you can actually make it a twofer if you go down there, because at 7:00 at night, Bellevue's playing, and they're ranked like number 2 in the nation in football, so that'd be an interesting team to watch. And then Eastside Catholic boys football team is undefeated, and they're in the semifinals in the 3A, and they're playing over in Spokane this weekend. So if you want to make a nice trip across the pass, you can go over there.
You plan to go to all this, don't you?
No, but I am going to the Tacoma Dome.
So there's a Jaron bus leaving if anyone wants to go?
We can carpool.
Thank you.
We had
Deputy Mayor James.
We had talked in the agenda meeting about possibly canceling the February 5th meeting. I'm looking at the future calendar. Mm-hmm. That's right on the heels of our retreat, annual retreat. So we don't necessarily have to cover it in this meeting, but if there's consensus, then maybe we should go ahead and remove it from the calendar.
And for the background, that just prior to that meeting, council will be working almost 20 hours of the retreat talking about various items, so it's probably appropriate to cancel that meeting.
In the month of January, we have 4 council meetings and a retreat, I believe.
Three council meetings.
Three and a retreat, okay. But effectively, fundamentally, 4 council meetings.
Right.
One of which is a retreat.
Wow.
Okay.
Can I have a consensus of the council to do that?
Sure.
Yes. Okay. I think you had it.
Sure.
Okay. Presentations and proclamations. We have none this evening. So we'll move on to public comment.
What about the consent? Did we do that one?
We'll do it when we get there. Public comment is an opportunity for the public to address the council. We allow 3 minutes per person or 5 minutes if you are representing the official position of a recognized community organization. I have a couple people that have signed up. I will be calling them first, and then we'll open it up for others who may wish to comment but have not signed up. When I do call your name, please come to the podium, and for the record, please give us your name and address. So the first person I have signed up is Joyce Reed. Joyce, would you please come to the podium and
clarify if they have talk at the hearing? I am Joyce Reed. I live in Sammamish off East Lake Sammamish Parkway. My concern is that lighting going in people's houses, bright lights going into the yards, using the wrong kind of lights. There's a situation where it's called light pollution in our area. It's bad for our eyes. It's bad for our habitat, our atmosphere, stars, animals, etc. And to control the pollution. And there's a big 21 pages on the internet about this. You can go on the internet and you can see it. And it's called Light Pollution under URLs, and you can read the 21 pages concerning all about this. There's a lot to it. I'm concerned. I'm coming here because in the city of Sammamish, there's no ordinance controlling lights going in people's yards, and I have damaged my right eye, and I care about my physical appearance, my health, and finding out that certain lights can be dangerous and cause temporary or permanent eye damage. I would like to have an ordinance passed in the city of Sammamish on proper lighting, and the proper lighting would be low sodium, mercury, halogen lights, and in yellow and in orange tones. When I came to the counter, I talked to Monica Davis, about it and concerned about this, and that's why I'm at the council meeting today, because I care about Sammamish. I have lived in Issaquah. I am a 66-year-old lady, and I run a business called Ambrosia, and I do hair, and I've ran the business for 35 years out of my house in East Lake Sammamish Parkway, legally. And I guess I know, knew Julius Bohm and very well in his business, of his candy business. And I would just like Sammamish to be a place where it's going to be nice to live and not have intruding lights trespassing your property and causing damage to your eyes, etc. The other issue I'm noticing that you'd have to pass an ordinance on this. There's no ordinance in Sammamish on this. In other cities, there is. Sammamish is the only place there is no ordinance controlling the lights. And I'm finding out also, my concern is, like, how many people is going to be living in Sammamish? How big is Sammamish going to really get? And is there an ordinance of how many people can really build and live in Sammamish? And I notice it's getting pretty crammed in here, the way I feel, because I've lived in my house since 1980, and now it is 2012. And of course, I like to grow, and I like to see things happen that are positive, but I see things maybe doing too much cramming in of people, I guess. So if it could be an ordinance on how many people could live in Sammamish, and I'm not for sure how many people live in Sammamish, actually, the population. Well,
thank you, Mrs. Reed. Ms. Okay. Reed. We will take your comments into consideration. The next I have Greg Reynolds.
Greg Reynolds, 4329, 210th Place, Northeast, Sammamish. Council members and city staff, I'm here today to make a comment on the budget. The 2013 budget contains a serious omission regarding the funding for connectivity. We've been working for many years to develop a process to evaluate the merits of improved connectivity within the city. The city staff, at the recommendation of previous councils, has developed a process that identifies the issues regarding barricaded streets in the community and works with the citizens' input to develop a workable plan that provides improved connectivity while being sensitive to the issues and concerns of the neighbors and residents regarding the removal of the barricades. The sudden withdrawal of the commitment by failing to provide funding for the staff to continue this process would be a major failure by the city to continue to do what is best for the citizens of and residents of Sammamish. I'm asking the council to restore funding for the connectivity in the 2013 budget so we can make Sammamish a more unified city. The barricade study process is essential in verifying the facts of the issue so that exaggerated claims of negative effects from barricade removal regarding traffic volumes and safety can be resolved with honest facts. There cannot be compromise without unity, and unity without the facts being verified by an expert, either city staff or experts hired by the city to identify what the facts are. If the council decides not to fund connectivity and to continue continue the connectivity process, then I ask that the city council honor the plat requirements that were established when several of the new subdivisions were built through the hearing examiner process by King County, which required street connections. Some of these street connections were subverted by the city of Sammamish after incorporation. And that's why we have the problem right now with several of the major barricades on the north end and the south end of the city. So that's basically all I have to say.
Thank you, Mr. Reynolds. That ends the
Could I just say one more thing? I've been working on this for 12 years, and I thought this was a good start, the connectivity process, And now to see the city pull the rug out from underneath the process is very disheartening. I mean, how long can we work on a project to get somewhere and then have the city pull the funding? It's just not right.
Is there anyone else who wishes to address the council at this time? Is there anyone else who wishes to make public comment at this time? Not seeing anyone, I am going to close public hearing. Okay, next on our agenda, we have the consent agenda. May I have a motion for approval of the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
We're moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Vote of 6-0, consent agenda is approved. Okay, we have a couple of public hearings this evening. The first one is the second reading relating to the levy of regular property taxes and establishing the amount to be levied in 2013 on the assessed value of the property within the city. Mr. City Manager, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm just wondering that if you're okay with, let me give the report for both of those public hearings, staff report. It's not a new stuff, and they're both are very closely related to each other. One is a budget, the other one is a property tax.
I don't have a problem with that. Does any member of the council have an issue with doing it this way?
No. Thank you.
But, so we're going to be doing, just to clarify, the second reading relating to the levying of regular property tax, and he will also discuss the adopting the biennial budget, and then our comments will be referring to both in one shot.
Correct.
Okay.
Sure. Thank you. Budget development process started way back in April. This council does not take the budget process lightly. As a matter of fact, this council takes the budget process very seriously and then spend a lot of time on it. On April 16 meeting, we met with the council, talk about the financial and economic update in the nation, region, and local. On May 14, council adopted the Parks Pro Plan, that is the six-year and an associated six-year capital improvement plan. June 16, we approved the Transportation Improvement Plan. That was a six-year plan. These sets the basic fundamentals of the budget that we started with. And then we were in the August recess while we were recessed, but the work didn't stop. Internally, I met with the department heads, departments, and also the employees, if needed be, employee committees, and prepared the draft budget. September 11, I presented the draft budget to the council. In that budget, we also went through departments. The first department that we reviewed was the Community Development Department. September 17 meeting, we went through the City Council, City Manager, Finance, and IT Department budgets. On October 2nd meeting, we went through the Public Works, Parks, and Facilities budget. October 9th, we went through the Public Works, Surface Water Management, Administrative Services, Police Department, Fire Department, and Legal Services budget. On October 15, Council take a look at the entire budget and suggested some additions and deletions. November 6, we had the public hearing, first reading, property tax levy, public hearing, first reading, surface water management fees, public hearings, first reading, real estate excise tax ordinance, first reading, and then the salary schedule. November 13, surface water management fees, second reading, REIT ordinance, and second reading. And tonight, we're at the final stage of the budget. This is a modest budget. It assumes that very little increase on the expense side. We went through streamlined page by page, if necessary, line by line, this council and the department heads and myself and finance department and the various study sessions. It is not a perfect budget. It's a legislative process. It does not necessarily address every individual council member's special needs or desires, but rather is the collective process that the council came up with that addresses the city needs. Tonight, we're at the final stage of this thing. While we're at the final stage that I'm seeking your approval of this budget, there are a couple issues that I heard from the various council members that I think you should take it very seriously, and I think that we can address them. Number one, it's related to Parks Department, that is the Southeast 8th Street Master Plan. I heard from some council members that they want to take a look at that, and they want to perhaps maybe hold back on some of the expenditures. But I suggest to you that keep the funding in the budget, but spend the time on the master plan to decide what needs to be done in 2013 and 2014. You still have to approve the master plan, and that will be brought back before you. My parks director isn't here, so I can't give you a specific date, but I'll try to bring it back to you as soon as I can, probably February, March timeline. Now, recognize this. Doing this would delay the project if, in fact, the council wanted to proceed with the project. So those of you who are supportive of this project, I want you to recognize that there will be some delays.
Mr. City Manager, does our parks director have a good excuse for not being here?
Yes, she's getting married, so she has a very good excuse to not to be here tonight.
I think that's just sliding there. We're losing Jesse Richardson and getting Jesse Bond.
Right. So I think that that's achievable, and we'll come back to the council. Then you take a look at the whole project and then tell us what it is that you want us to build or not build in 2013-14. Second issue is related to economic development. This is one concern that we heard consistently from one or two council members. They have expressed some concerns that the capital dollars that we put in the budget continues to be a concern, especially that when we look at the overall city needs and the sidewalks and the parks and the and facilities. Not that they're suggesting at this point that we take priority over one versus the other, but because there's a relatively large number of dollars put in the budget in the economic development, they want us to take a look at on the capital side of the economic development. On the capital side, this council had $3 million from previous biennial budget that was allocated for Southeast 4th Street improvements. This year's budget that I had proposed for your consideration was that the $1 million for regional storm drainage detention pond, $500,000 for local improvement district improvements. So those are the dollar figures that I suggest that we have a study session in February, March timeline, and we take a look at it. This doesn't mean that there are other components of economic development that we have to stop. As a matter of fact, I feel that there is a unanimous support for those components, particularly for the economic development plan. And we need to do that. That is a roadmap for us, for our city. That is supported by the full council. The other part is also the unified zoning development plan, a small amount that we put in the budget to help that spearhead to some of the development activities within the town center. Mayor, council, this has been a long process. I spent a lot of time on this thing. Your staff spent a lot of time on this thing. I think my finance department probably put the most time and effort on it, and they're probably sick and tired of my daily request of information and the changes before I come before you to make the presentation on the various components of this budget. So I strongly recommend that you approve the 2013-2014 biennial budget with the caveats that I had articulated, and that 2013-14 biennial budget number is $153,637,689. That includes with transfers and ending fund balances. The budget also has the property tax component in it. Once again, this council is being sensitive to the current economic conditions. The council decided not to take the authority that the council has to impose additional 1% increase on the property taxes. So the levy that we're going to be collecting will be consistent with the, without any property tax increase, the levy amount is $21,825,000. City will not be imposing additional 1% property tax as per council's direction. With that, Mr. Mayor, I would recommend that you open the public hearing, close the public hearing after the testimony, council deliberation, and your city manager's strong recommendation for the approval of the budget and property tax levy ordinances.
Thank you, Mr. City Manager. Are there questions from council for the city manager before I open the public hearing? Councilmember Valderrama?
Yes, to the city manager, we've also discussed reanalyzing going forward for the next biennium budget, the budgeting process to include, as was discussed on October 15th, a separate alternative budget, whether it's zero-based budgeting or a negative budget alternative being presented. And I understand that that will be worked into the process going forward. Is that correct, City Manager?
Well, that is your desire, Councilmember Valderrama. You're talking about the 2015 and 2016 biennial budget, and I appreciate that you're being sensitive to 13-14 schedule. We're almost at the end of it. What Councilmember Valderrama would like to see is that perhaps a little bit more detailed information. What I do share with you is that condensed version of the documents is, when you look at what I have, is actually is a zero-based budgeting. Every department has to justify every expenditure is greater than $500. I can't go below $500 that I will be spending my entire year doing nothing but the budget. But your 90% of expenditures, well, actually 95% of your expenditures, are greater than $500. What I suggest that we do is that perhaps that the council may consider having a council finance committee as a whole with a couple study sessions. So I'll go through with those details and share with you what we mean with the zero-based budget. And then after you looked at that information, if you need something more, we can make an adjustment to it. This is 2014 September timeline we're talking about it. That will be the time that we'll be talking about the 2015-2016 budget cycle. Does that answer your question?
It does. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Councilmember Whitten.
My concern about economic development funding was that we have not, in the process that has been used, taken a look at these expenditures in the context of, one, the town center plan and what other changes we might or might not want to it to tweak it, and then in the broader of competing priorities. So I don't feel you quite got the full scope of what I was hoping would happen, is that before you came back with us for authorization to fund specific things in the town center, we would do town center visioning per se with this council, and then also have a broader discussion of should we be putting this much money into the economic development plan, or even more of it, versus other competing things that clearly are a priority to our citizens.
I got it, and we'll have a study session scheduled. I'll talk with the mayor, deputy mayor, to make that happen.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Councilmember Jern.
Mr. City Manager, there was a citizen who talked about the connectivity and it not being in the budget. Under the street fund, is there sufficient flexibility that if next year we decide to continue the connectivity process with another project, we can find funds for that study?
Yes. Typically, if the council directs us to do that, we certainly could do that. But if there's a desire of the council to undertake such work activity, I would like to know that as early as possible, not later than perhaps the end of January or February timeline, so we can plug in enough resources. My public works director is looking at me very angry from the back of the room.
No, she's looking at Don.
Not that she's opposed to this project. All her concern has to do with is that as the managing the resources that she has. So answer to your question, yes, we can allocate resources from the street fund, internal funds. And what I beg council to do is please to let me know as early as possible if that is what you want us to do. Mm-hmm.
Councilmember Whitten.
That be something to discuss at the retreat at the end of the January?
We can, but, you know, we'll take a look at what the
retreat
is. That's
where we usually discuss our work plans.
Well, This retreat, we're going to do it perhaps a little bit different format, so we're looking, I'll share with you. Give me some time on that one.
Deputy Mayor James?
How much did we spend to do the Southeast 32nd Street study?
Well, it wasn't the study that we spent a lot of time. We had a consultant helping us to looking at the old barricades. It wasn't only Southeast 32nd. And then the capital cost that we spent, I don't remember the dollar figures. Laura, do you remember top of your head?
It's around 230.
Yeah, over 350, I think it was in that area.
Did that include the mitigations?
Yeah, that's what I'm talking
about. Well, I don't think that Mr. Reynolds is asking that the actual improvements to be made in 13. If I understand him correctly, is that to get the council decision, start the process and make the council decision. Laura?
The mitigation costs were close to 300,000, you know, plus or minus. I don't remember exact number. The actual study portion of it was probably less than 30,000, but a significant amount of staff time.
The decision to, the process to get to decision point was about a $30,000. But once you made a decision that the barricade had to be removed, the contract and capital improvements were about the $300,000+. So when I answered to Council Member Jaron's question, I thought he was referring to that, the $30,000 small amount. If we talk about $300,000, that I don't have that flexibility, so we may have to come back and revisit the ending fund balance if you make a decision to do something else with that.
Mm-hmm. Councilmember Whitten.
My concern with this barricade is it just from looking at it, it appears to be very dangerous with very little options to make mitigations that would be meaningful given the grades and the turns, and that we might need to have an independent safety consultant come out to look at this in toto.
Well, Nancy, that may be the case, but to be honest, we have not had that analysis done yet. So.
No, I know that. Mm-hmm. I know that. I realize that. I'm just saying I think it might cost, in this case, more than $30,000.
Okay. Councilmember Valderrama?
I've seconded the recommendation by Councilmember Whitten as far as during the retreat trying to do that visioning exercise, pending the limitations, obviously, that the city manager has mentioned. Since we have a little bit of a jambalaya here on some of the items, as we're talking about the items of the budget, I wanted just to make sure that when we go back to the Parks Director, formerly known as Jesse Richardson, that you also convey to her the concern of several of the council members as we look at that master plan, that currently that house is going to be utilized in a different way than was envisioned prior to the community center. And until that's determined, there are a significant number of council members who would prefer to see the parking of both in front of the house on the street and on the other side limited at this point in time. And that obviously we'll visit it during the master plan, but if you'll convey that to her, that would be beneficial.
Mr. City Manager.
Thank you. I'll just make a quick comment. We don't need to address the both of these issues tonight. Tonight is we're talking about a property tax levy ordinance and then the council, the budget ordinance. But I do appreciate that your detailed input to me. On the first one, if the council wants to add it to our work plan, that the sometime in January or February timeline, we have resources, we may have to tap into some of our ending fund balance to make it happen. On the second one, I want to be fair to my public works parks director. She was here about a week ago. She made a presentation. We all assumed that we got an input. So obviously we're now hearing a different input at this time. That's okay, that's your prerogative, and it's our job as your staff to accommodate that. I wait till we get, till she gets back, and then we'll sit down and talk at the study session to find out what is the collective vision of the council, what it is that you want to do. And then we reflect that on the master plan.
Thank you.
I think it's probably useful to keep in mind, particularly as we talk about parks plans, that, and this one in particular, we're at the end of a very long process with this park, at least for this stage of this park, keeping in mind this is the first of three. And there's been an awful lot of public input, an awful lot of discussion. I think we've had at least two study sessions on it, and that's not even talking about the pro plan. So there's been an awful lot of talk about this already. If there are individual pieces of any given plan, and I certainly have had my share of problems with some of them, then the way to deal with that is at the time of funding the proposal to move forward with a amendment to the plan at that point. But I think it would not be a great idea to completely reopen the books at this point on this until such time as we're actually presented with an action item that involves spending money. I spent 5 years of my life as a financial controller for a large corporation with over 100 cost centers and a $60 million month operating budget, an equally large capital budget. So I'm very sensitive to the amount of work that's gone into this budget. And believe me, I've known it, I sweated it, I hated it. And at the end of it, I still had to look at forward to starting over again for the next round. So I appreciate the work that staff and city manager have put into this. Yes, there's always a better way to do things, and maybe we can work on that. But for the sake of moving forward here, I think you know, we can talk about the individual things at the right time, but right now we're dealing with the overall big picture. Tom, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I think we need to have our public hearing and then deliberate.
A what?
Then deliberate.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, let's open the public hearing on both of these. We're opening the public hearing on both the levy assessment and the budget as a whole. So at this point, I'm going to open the public hearing. Are there members of the audience who wish to address the council on this subject? And I see our clerk is looking. There's no one signed up. So is there anyone who wishes to address the council on either the tax levy or the budget itself? Not seeing anyone, I'm going to close public hearing and open deliberations. Deliberations are now open.
You have to have a motion.
Mr. City Manager, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to adopt the city's 2013 property tax levy.
Okay, thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt the city's 2013 tax levy. Discussion?
Call the question. Sorry, okay. Can I withdraw that?
Not seeing any discussion. We're ready.
Hold
for
on a second.
Whoa. I'm sorry.
I won't miss the opportunity.
You didn't have your hand higher.
Well, I was going to give the others a chance first, I think.
Okay. Council Member Valderrama has the floor.
Thank you. This is my first budget cycle that I'm going through with the city, and I'm appreciative of all the work that's been put in, particularly by Joe, Chris, and the staff on the finance department. As I have mentioned before, I do have a lot of concerns with the budget and the process. I'm hopeful that the new process that we're trying to look at having in place, where we will be able to look at a zero-based budget, will give us a more of a perspective to be able to see the forest and the trees. I have been concerned about the biennium budgets in these economic times going 8% higher. I have been concerned, as I have cited previously, particularly about the Parks and Recreation Department in 2009 to 2011 going up 15.5%, and those issues not being addressed, and hopefully the new process will go forward and start to address those. I am very concerned that we live within our means, and in particular the area of the parks, as I had mentioned previously. I love the parks. I'm a heavy user of them. I was just estimating now that I use the community parks at least 5 times a week. That's why we moved here. And even the parks that we have here are probably one of the major reasons, and we've seen that in the surveys as to people being here. But it has to be sustainable, and the process that we're undergoing now I don't think is fair to our citizens, because if we continue this process, I don't believe we're going to be able to sustain and maintain the parks to the conditions that we're used to, and we need to be able to evaluate them. At an earlier time, when we were looking at Eastside Fire and Rescue, we had the issues being raised of their growth rate, and we had recommended a technical advisory board. I had asked for a technical advisory board in the case of this budget. That was not accepted by the council, but I would hope that as we go forward, we take a serious look at what's taking place in the parks, which is our biggest line item, and depending if you look with transfers or not, 13% of our budget, and next after the public safety, because we all love the parks, and we'd like to make sure that we're properly sustaining that. Additionally, I'd like to be able to look, as we go forward, at how our staff, who we have a wonderful staff here, they're doing a great job here, and I want to make sure we reiterate that. But as we start looking at new staff being brought on this economic times, and we compare what we're doing here to what's been reported being done in Redmond, Kirkland, Bellevue, and other cities, we're not in the norm. They're different cities, but with the hires that are taking place, the deputy mayor and myself have asked questions about some of the hires, and including the policemen that I still don't understand the hiring, and I'm on the public safety committee. So I think we have to look and scrutinize that budget much more closely as we go forward, and I'm hopeful that with the new process, we'll be able to address that and be able to look at the budget in its totality. Thank you.
I have a question.
Deputy Mayor James?
Are we just doing item five right now? Or
no, both.
Yes.
The motion was for both?
Item
no,
five.
No, yeah. Just oh. Item five.
So you were talking
point.
About the budget, so oh. I just wanted to clarify that.
Oh, thank you.
You get a second chance?
I shall be back to take a bite of that apple.
Can you just, you know, replay what you said?
Yeah. Just say ditto.
Yes. Anybody have any further comment on the tax?
Larry call the issue? Question?
Well, it looks like...
my question was...
Council go. Member Vance's...
No, I'm ready okay. to vote aye.
You're cool? Okay.
He's just anxious to pull the trigger.
All right. So, are we ready for the question? I guess we are. All in favor of the tax levy ordinance as proposed, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, say nay. By our vote of 6-0, the levy is approved for 2013-2014.
Thank you, Council.
Number is that?
And that is ordinance. Thank you. That is ordinance number 02012-336. And I need to point out for everybody that this is the fourth year in a row that your council has not increased the property tax levy. The increase is banked for future use, so we're not totally walking away from it. But for the foreseeable future, we will be holding the tax levy flat. So are we ready to move on to the next issue?
Mayor?
And that is the 2013-2014 biennial budget. May we have a motion?
Yeah. Move.
I move that we adopt the 2013 and 2014 biennial budget.
Thank you. I take you as a
second.
As a second. It's been moved and seconded to adopt the 2013/14 biennial budget. That is ordinance number 02012-337. Is there discussion?
Councilmember Valderrama already made his comments, so we'll make sure that in the meeting minutes, those comments are reflected on this
in the right in the right place.
Yes, in the right place. But I do want to add a comment onto that.
Let me ask if there's anybody else.
Exactly.
Let him. Councilmember Witt and then Councilmember Jared.
Councilmember Romero and I concurred in terms of our concern about the economic development projects. I do think they need to be. I'm concerned about the process and how they got here at the last minute as a budget item rather than coming to us earlier for a study session in the context of what our overall city priorities should be in terms of where we spend our money and also within the context of the town center. I was originally going to, I concur, I think staff's done a great job. I concur with almost all of the budget. I am concerned about the economic development items, but with the understanding from our city manager that it will be coming, they will never not seek authorization to spend that until we've had those broader discussions. I am in favor of this budget and want to thank staff for doing just a great job. I know it's taken not just our city managers and our finance director and his staff, but also all the department heads and everybody in the city is involved in putting all these threads together to come up with one document, and the city then fine-tunes it terms of what our goals are for the next 2 years. So I'm very pleased with the process, and I wanted to thank staff for that and say I'm very happy to be able to support this budget and understood that if I hadn't and Romero hadn't, that we might have had some problems passing with all the concerns. And I'm very pleased to see people have worked it out, and it's sad, very happy to do so.
Thank you, Councilmember Wythe.
Thank you. Councilmember Jarrett?
I would also like to congratulate the city manager, the finance director, and all the staff for putting together a very readable budget, as municipal budgets go, and very thorough explanation of it. And I also appreciated the response to citizens who had questions about the budget, very thorough responses, and thank you very much for that. I'm looking forward to operating under this budget in the next, well, at least the next year for me.
Thank you, Councilmember Jarrett.
Councilmember Valderrama?
Ditto to my earlier comments to be put into place. One thing that I wanted to mention, and we've talked about the levy, and I thought it was prudent given the economic times that we did not take the 1% this year. However, given the increases in our operating budget, and correct me if I'm wrong, it's between 2.5 and 3% this year, the operating expense increase. So we clearly, again, in addition to the other increases that I mentioned, have to be able to look at some cuts coming into play if we're going to live within our means here. And I would hope that as we start to go forward in the next process, that's brought forward and we start to look at that and make that also transparent to the council and how that will be done.
Can I ask for one clarification? Okay. You, by that, you mean operating revenues versus operating expenses
exactly.
Versus capital. Thank you.
Exactly. Thank you.
Okay. Deputy Mayor James.
When we started the budget process, we were also talking about a community and aquatic center, and that was put out to a public advisory vote, and the public has stated and a majority has spoken, and there had been some talk in our agenda meeting about giving some direction to our city manager about taking next steps with the Y as soon as our next meeting. In light of that, we've had a huge safety net in our city of having a huge capital reserve compared to most of our sister cities in the region. That safety net, some of which will be spent on the new community aquatic center should that go forward and we reach a operating agreement with the Y that's satisfactory for our citizens. I probably am more inclined now to be a little bit more tougher on financial management of the city going forward without that safety, as big a safety net as we've had in the past. So I think this is a budget that works for now, but the next budget cycle, I think the council has some harder work to do, especially if we're not raising revenues at the same time we're increasing expenses. Our partners, we're a contract city, also need to realize it's not a bottomless pit, and we appreciate their understanding that, you know, keeping costs in line are something we're going to be focusing on quite diligently. So I'm going to be voting for this budget unless somebody tells me something between now and the time the question is called to change my mind. But I am saying that we need to have a prudent outlook on behalf of our city going forward. It meets its purpose today. The next budget might not be so generous.
Anyone else? Councilmember Jarrett.
Just one other comment about raising revenues. Although we're not increasing the property tax levy, sales tax revenues are up. Real estate excise tax revenues are up enormously, mm-hmm. Projected some $700,000 over this year over the budgeted amount. So revenues are increasing even without our major source, property tax. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Vance, we haven't heard from you.
Yes, I just wanted to give my appreciation for city staff, city manager, the finance department, all of the department heads for doing a wonderful job. This is the first time I've worked on this budget from this side as opposed to sitting in the audience and just being a critic. And it was a very interesting process. I think what we've ended up with is a very, very good budget. And I appreciate, I will appreciate along with Councilmember Jarrett working under this budget for at least the next 2 years. So I appreciate all the hard work, and we'll vote yes on this budget.
Thank you, Councilmember Vance.
Okay. Are we ready? May I have a motion to approve the budget? No, we've already done that, sorry. Call the question. All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed, say nay. By a vote of 6-0, the 2013-2014 budget is approved. And that ordinance again is 02012-337.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, council members. Appreciate your recognition of the staff's hard work. And I want to also thank my finance director, my deputy finance director, and all my department heads. They have been tirelessly working on this thing. Thank you all. I'm very proud of you.
Okay. Very good and well done. Now, moving on, we have no unfinished business at this point, old business. Under new business, we have a resolution amending resolution R2011-467, which is the city's master fee schedule. And Mr. City Manager, I...
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is another component of the budget. We talk about some of these issues. I'm going to ask our finance director to give us a very brief staff report on this one. So it's a pretty straightforward issue. The components of this thing were discussed, and perhaps one component is not necessarily discussed. That is related to credit card billing charges. Joe? This is the 90-page PowerPoint that you were planning on presenting it.
I'm all out of 90-page PowerPoint presentations. I think
I
got
go more than nine.
Three here for you. There we go. Okay, the 2013 master fee schedule, this is, even though we're on a biennial budget, every year we go through, we recalibrate our fees, we take a look at if there's any errors or omissions, and if anything's changed to where we update our fee schedule. This year there's three items throughout the master fee schedule that was sent to you, and it's in a redline version. Once adopted, we'll clean that up. Want to make it easy for you to track the changes. One is the permitting service fees and parks facility rental fees are increased by 1.5%. That is going to cover the cost of allowing us to take credit cards in and allowing people to pay for their permits and parks registration by credit card. Second set of changes to the stormwater fees that we discussed with you earlier. And then the third set is the right-of-way construction permits. Quickly with the credit card fee recovery, this is to cover the charge that we get from the bank when somebody pays for something via credit card. We are currently accepting credit card payments now through mybuildingpermit.com, but that's the only avenue for our customers at this point. It's allow folks to come in with make credit card payment at the counter for permit service fees and park rentals. We're assuming that approximately 55% of the customers will pay with credit cards. That's consistent with what we heard from the other jurisdictions. We did the analysis, we broke it down by permit type or facility rental type, came out in total to be about 55%. In our budget, we're considering $30,000 that we're gonna be recovering through the merchant fees from the bank. And so we've done a 1.5% increase across the board. Now the merchant fees, per transaction will probably be more along the lines of 2.5%, but this way it doesn't matter if you're paying by cash or credit card, everybody's paying the same amount, so we don't have that corner gas station look where you get a cash and a credit card discount. Stormwater fees, last week through Ordinance 12334, you've adopted the system development charges. This is the complementary piece on the operating budget side. This is the annual surface water management rate. And recall that from our 2012 rate to 2013, 18% increase. And for your consideration in 2014, per our study by the consultant we brought in to help us with our rate studies, It will be an additional 15% in 2014. This is only, fee schedule is only covering the 2013 portion of that. And finally, our right-of-way permits. There is one slight change to Type B construction permits. We've split out the fee structure to two tiers. So if you're coming in with a smaller project, and the example we're using is you have a crack in your driveway and you want to come out and get your driveway repaired, under the old system, you would pay that $471 up front plus staff time. This is keeping that at a flat fee of $100. And then if you have a project evaluation of greater than $5,000, now the fee will be $471 plus $118 per hour for staff time spent.
Councilmember Whitten has a question.
Yes, that $5,000 is the cost of what the project is estimated to cost?
Correct, the project valuation.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. And with that, we ask for tonight's recommended action to adopt the 2013 Master Fee Schedule Resolution.
Okay, thank you. Questions for the finance director on this? None? Okay. There are no questions. May we have a motion?
So move.
Second. Been moved and seconded that we adopt the master fee schedule as amended for 2013. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed say nay. And motion carries 6-0. Then that resolution number is R2012-514.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Okay. The next item we have on the agenda is Council Reports. And I'm going to start on my far right. And call on Council Member Vance. Do you have a report this evening?
Yes. excuse me. The one committee meeting that I have gone to was the funding model task force for Eastside Fire and Rescue, that of which I'm the chair. That committee continues its examination of various funding models, and I'm guessing over the next few weeks we will get a little more particular on what kind of funding models the different partners would like to explore, at least. So not much more to say than that, but our discussions are continuing. We'll be meeting next week, not this week, and then we'll be meeting again twice in December, actually. That's it.
Thank you. Councilmember Valderrama?
Yes, also with the Eastside Fire and Rescue, in addition to the other responsibilities, I'm on the Service Delivery Task Force, as is our Council Member Gerund here, and I'm pleased to report that the EFNR Service Delivery Model has been moving forward. We have expanded our areas that we're looking at to include not only the first calls areas that are being covered by each of the different fire stations and that area of coverage, as well as the service and support between fire stations. We also have been looking at the staffing levels of service and are going to continue to move forward in both of those as we go forward in our meetings later this month and in December.
Thank you. Is that it?
That's it.
On the service delivery question, a couple of things. First of all, I note that the move-up information that was brought forth a couple of weeks ago showed us some interesting things about what stations are being moved up and how often.
Absolutely.
And the burden is primarily falling on two stations, one of which is ours, which effectively takes the station out of our service area. The other question I have, though, which is related to it, is last year we, because of budget restrictions at EFER, initiated a brownout program. When we're short on overtime pay capability, they would take stations down from a three-man to two-man, and then if they were going below that, they completely closed the station.
I would hope that in the course of the service delivery discussions that we would have data made available on the number of times each of the stations within the East Side Fire Service Area was browned out.
We will follow up on that, and to your earlier point, the call-up and move-ups, as they call it, when you respond, is being looked at, and there's even been suggestions that we have further discussions on one of our stations being considered a regional station under the EFER umbrella.
All right, thank you. Mr. Mayor. Deputy Mayor James.
Last Thursday, I attended with Tom O'Dell, the Enterprise Seattle, I should say the organization formerly known as Enterprise Seattle, because as a voting member and a board member, we changed our name back to Economic Development Council of Seattle King County. It was seen that it plays better throughout the county because it is a countywide organization. My term as a board member, and here's another irony, another group just changed its name. Suburban Cities Association is now called Sound Cities. So my term as a Sound City appointee ends this year, and Tom O'Dell has applied. He still has to be nominated. Mm-hmm. Hopefully he'll be able to carry on with the new entity known as Economic Development Council of Seattle King County with his aerospace background, and that being one of the pillars of development that they're working on. And the airline business, hopefully that'll serve them well if they choose to select Tom from that appointment. In regards to Eastside Transportation Partnership, I had requested our city clerk pass out a letter that was distributed at our last meeting. At our next meeting, Eastside Transportation Partnership had asked that each city council or representative get approval to have a letter sent to the state legislators, and the letter was distributed by email. It was also passed out here this evening. I just need authorization on behalf of myself and Don Gerund, who's also a voting representative as well, and or the alternate if one of us can't be there, Tom O'Dell, to give our nod that this letter is acceptable and one that the city of Sammamish supports.
So moved.
I'm not sure we need a formal motion, do we, on this? Or
it'd be nice. So it's been
okay. Let's. May I have a motion to authorize the Eastside Transportation Partnership representatives to vote in support of this letter?
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay.
Well, he wanted discussion. Real quick on the draw here.
Just trying to hurry up, Romero.
You got to wake up early to beat me to this.
Yes, sir.
I have a question on point number one as I was looking at it. Develop and fund
That's the wrong document.
Oh, this is not the one? Which
no,
one is
this
now?
One.
Oh, all right. I'll hold mine. Next one.
Very good.
All right.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
Maybe we could have a friendly amendment to include support of the ETP 2013 legislative statement.
Actually, I think that's an excellent idea. So that takes us back to Ramiro's question.
Right.
So,
all right.
Ramiro's stage is yours again.
All these jambalayas that we're doing here. Okay.
What is it? Is that a technical term? I'm trying to understand.
Jumbo. Food.
No, it's what I had for dinner two nights ago.
Food here. On point number one that you have here, develop and fund a transportation package through an increase in state gas tax or other revenue sources. So when they're urging the state legislature, and so since we're talking about an increase in taxes, and that I was wondering if there's been any background information that you can share with us as to what's been discussed to date on that before we go forward.
I'll let our two ETP members take that one on.
Don, you want to tackle this as you
sure.
Brought it up?
I think both the newly elected governor and the candidate that didn't get elected both supported a transportation package going to a vote of the public either next year or at least in the biennium. And there's pretty much a consensus in regional forums that that there is new revenue needed to both fund some of the critical capital projects in which we itemize here, Eastside Transportation ones, and also fund maintenance and operations. I think we've heard from our county councilwoman, Kathy Lambert, that county roads are in danger of ending up in gravel from lack of maintenance. So, so with all the strong pressure on this and the recognition that gas tax revenues are flat or going down because of the more efficient automobiles, there is a need for a new, either increase the gas tax, perhaps index it to an inflation, and or provide a different revenue source. And I am on a state steering committee, as I mentioned before, on road usage charge as a possible way of either supplanting or augmenting state gas tax.
Thank you for that clarification, Councilmember Jura.
Other comment? Okay. We're back to the motion. All in favor
of the letter first?
We combined them.
Of combining, well, we've combined these
two. Yeah.
All in favor of approving the draft letter from ATP to the legislators, say aye. And all in favor of approving the 2013 ETP legislative statement, say aye. Let's just do it as one aye, please.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, say nay. By our vote of 6-0, both are approved.
Thank you, Council. Thank you, Mayor.
Are you done?
Yeah, I'm done.
Okay. Councilmember Whitten?
I'm going to have no comment right now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Councilmember Jared.
Thank you. The Finance Committee met just before this session, and we reviewed the October Financial Management Report, and it's nothing but good. As I mentioned, real estate excise tax is coming in higher than projected. And, so that was very good. We also had a discussion about the fiscal year 2011 audit, and we had a clean audit, no findings last again. Then we also discussed the budget process update, and we beat that to death. So that was our Finance Committee meeting.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. From my standpoint, as Deputy Mayor James pointed out, I accompanied him to the Enterprise Seattle, also known as Economic Development Commission of Council of Seattle and King County. I yet remain to be formally appointed to it. I have applied through Suburban Sound Cities Association. Boy, all these name changes. But we learned in the meeting that the Deputy Mayor and I attended that they are increasing the number of board members by a substantial number. As they attempt to broaden their representation and move to more towards a King County perspective than a Seattle perspective. So I remain hopeful that I will be selected in the end. Other activity, actually was a pretty calm week, frankly, from a committee viewpoint. So I'm not going to go very far into all that. I do want to return, though, to one of the subjects we talked about earlier, and that is people who may be thinking of running for public office. When they do run for public office, they need to look at the time commitment required and ask themselves if they can do it. If they can't, then they need to maybe think twice. Now, we all get into situations where our circumstance changes. And at that point, you do your best and make sure that you can live up to your commitments. But if you do reach a point where you cannot, then perhaps it's time to ask yourself some tough questions. We do have, going forward, wonderful opportunity in front of us. Deputy Mayor James referred to it earlier this evening, and that is the vote on the community center came in favor of it, 53% and change. I take that as a strong endorsement.
and I look forward to completing the process with the Y as we go through the next couple of months. This whole thing may move a little bit faster than we originally thought it would, and we remain hopeful that all the I's will be dotted in the right place and the T's will be crossed in the right place when we get this for our decision in coming weeks. Personally, I think this is going to be a great addition to the city, and I felt that way since before I was elected to the council. As I just repeatedly said when I doorbelled, that was the most frequently mentioned need on the part of our residents for a facility of that nature. So I'm going to cut it off there and ask the city manager for his reports. A couple of things to cover, right?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yeah, I do have a few reports. Starting with the, I wanted to give you the East Side Fire Rescue Fire Study Report. But before I do that, I want to thank our Chief Tryon is coming over here. So he's sitting there patiently in the audience. And I hope that we don't get into too much details tonight on this report, because I don't frankly have not that much details for you. So I'm going to give the report. I'm going to ask Mike to help me to move the PowerPoints accordingly. Before I start doing that, I want to thank the Councilmember Vance, Councilmember Valderrama, Councilmember Jaron, and also Mayor O'Dell participating in this process, along with the Mike Sauerwein, Administrative Services Director, and the Lyman Howard is the Deputy City Manager. Well, in September 17, you passed the resolution, you asked me to do certain things, and since then, we took our concerns to the council, the East Side Fire Rescue, but in that resolution, you outlined the things that needed to be accomplished. One, you wanted to make sure that the funding model for operations that includes some sort of a different funding formula than what we have. Currently, our entire funding formula is based on the assessed value of each partner. And the Sammamish's desire, through the technical committee that the Sammamish had established, a while back, is the goal with the 50% perhaps AV and 50% the call for services. And the other things, that retention of existing veto powers, crediting emergency medical services levy collections that are attributable to each jurisdiction, and that is the transparency, not that any funds going to be cut or deleted or increased. But we just want to make sure that what each partner is contributing on the emergency medical services levy to be specified in the budget. Base equipment facilities reserve funds that needed to be addressed. Retention of the city's ownership of capital assets with building maintenance responsibility retained by the city. 18 months notice of determination. Some of these are easy. Some of those are very challenging issues to be addressed. Some of them, I think, that we already heard from the other partners, they don't have necessarily any issue with, they're okay with. That is the retention of existing veto powers. If you get that, there's no longer need to have the 18 months notice of termination. The other issue that we heard from the other partners, there's some sort of a support on the equipment facilities reserve fund contribution on usage, or perhaps the retention of the city ownership of capital assets with building maintenance responsibility retained by the city. We didn't hear and much of objection to it. Clearly, the big one is that the funding formula issue. And however you do that, somebody's going to get affected from it. Mm-hmm. If you devise a one funding formula that may benefit the Sammamish, that also has the potential of adversely affecting the other partners. And so we need to be sensitive to that, as they have been sensitive to us. The East Side Fire Rescue has been responsive. They immediately formed the two committees to deal with this issues, Funding Formula Committee and Service Delivery Model Committee. As you heard from the reports of the previous council members, our council members are intimately involved in each one of those processes, and I do appreciate their efforts and energy into it. I have attended the most...
Can you just stop for a minute for the benefit of people watching at home, explain very quickly who these board members are?
From Sammamish side?
Oh, not necessarily from Sammamish, but in general, the fact that there's some staff and there's some board of director members on it.
Well, the obviously you have three cities, and three cities have seven council members each, so you have 21 elected officials that are directly or indirectly involved in this thing. Mm-hmm. Then you have the staff, city managers, who are typically like to get their fingers into everything, so they're involved in this thing. You got the fire chiefs, public safety directors, in our cases is our administrative services director. They're involved. There's quite a large contingent here that we have to satisfy, and that is the challenge for Eastside Fire Rescue, to be able to find a model that satisfies everybody's needs. But clearly, we articulated our needs. Clearly, the other partners recognize the desire to look at this, the Sammamish's needs. They're interested in addressing it. That's why they took it seriously. That's why we're going through this process right now. In reality, some of the issues that Sammamish is raising, they have to be addressed, whether it's requested by Sammamish or not. Our makeup of the partnership is changing. Geographic boundaries are changing. Our model of service delivery is changing. Our response time is changing. So it was timely. It's not only because the Sammamish asked for these things. These are also timely things for this organization to look at it. Committee includes representatives from all cities. I try to attend the most of those meetings. Unfortunately, last two meetings I was not able to attend, partly because I had a conflict here at the City Hall with the other matters. One is related to the budget. The other one was the one development activity that I had to be here. But again, I want to thank the council members for attending and participating in this process. It's been very helpful to me. Funding model committee, they are looking at the history of the current funding model. They're also talking about the models used by other fire departments. I put an attachment in your packet. There are maybe 150 different ways of doing this. And I appreciate the EFIR staff's workload on this. They're trying to make this thing at the manageable level. I have to tell you also, I was proud of the all board members who participated in this process, that they have been very respectful and understanding and supportive of each other. So far, things are going quite well. Service Delivery Model Committee is not the one that I can say that good about it, because the chair of the committee is our council member. I'm just giving you a hard time. Now, it is going quite well, actually. Both of our council members are doing a great job. This is the one that we're talking about, what fire station is responding to what area, what backup that we're providing for what stations. It tends to be pretty complicated, but I think the beauty of this analysis is going to give us better way of delivering services in the long run. No questions, so that completes the report. It's a brief report. I just wanted to give you, as you requested from you, as your city manager. So if there is no question on this item, I want to move on to the
Not
second
so
critical
fast.
Item.
Despite the city manager's loaded statement, here are there questions for the city manager and staff on this report? Councilmember Jerry.
Not a question, just a comment that the Service Delivery Task Force is very responsible and have really dug into some of the nuances of the service delivery model.
Let me suspect that you were on that committee, Councilmember.
What do you think?
Awesome.
Why do you think? With respect to the service delivery thing, though, my comment earlier about the brownouts.
We will follow up on that.
Yeah, we are. And I have to say that I've been very impressed with the whole committee's behavior and everybody's, clearly some of these things are very sensitive topics that affects the different jurisdictions a different way. But so far, we didn't have to call the cops. Everybody's behaving all right. We're doing a good job.
That's because they keep providing cookies. Ben, at our meeting this morning, we talked about the possibility of using the retreat as our first gate review
timing.
If we are ready, Mr. Mayor, we'll try to do it. So I don't want to artificially push the process as long as we all notice that there's a good faith effort is taking place.
There. Well, by gate review doesn't mean everything is all wrapped up with a bow on it.
Oh, so you wanted a city manager's presentation with ample opportunity for questions. Is that what you're saying, Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
We will do that. Mm-hmm. We will do that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, that brings us...
One more item, Mr. Mayor. And that is important. This is the 2013 Comprehensive Plan Amendment docket request. Mm-hmm. This is the one that the municipal code requires us to request from citizens if they want any amendments to be considered. We take those, we compile them, we put together our draft recommendation for council to consider it. Tonight... we're going to simply introduce you, so please hold back on your questions. You will have an ample opportunity next week when we have our community development director here to discuss this more details. So I'm going to turn it over to our deputy city manager, Lyman Howard, to give a brief report on this. Lyman?
Great. Thank you, Ben, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. Our city clerk is passing out one of the requests for the docket. You have a memo from Cameron Grawl, our community development director, in your packet, directed to the city manager. This brief presentation will just highlight the points that we're trying to raise. As Ben mentioned, the annual comprehensive plan docket process, the comprehensive plan can be open once per year. That happens in September, where we call for docket requests. And then in December, council determines which docket requests will be included in the annual comprehensive plan study for potential changes. Council is under no obligation to include those docket requests in the annual comprehensive plan study. Historically, I'll point out that the council has generally refused to advance the requests and has then basically decided later to look at them as part of the general multi-year comprehensive plan adjustment if council decides that it is deemed necessary. There have been four docket requests submitted. The first one is a town center plan amendment for Southeast Quadrant and density increase related to that. Greg Kipp, gross density change to the R1 zoning methodology. Kinder Air Ace LLC, Michael Reed and Associates, and the City of Sammamish Public Works Department a transportation level of service docket request. I'll briefly just touch base on what these are. The memo that you have in your packet gives a greater in-depth review of them, but this is just a high-level look. This particular docket request would renew the docket request from 2009 that attempted to increase the commercial development capacity along with the other topics related to the town center plan. Staff does not recommend advancing this proposal to the 2013 docket, but it has instead recommended that the group participate in the 2013 economic development plan that will inform many of the issues or topics raised. The second item, the Greg Kipp gross density change to the R1 zoning. This is a request to change the development code for R1 zone properties to allow that gross density calculation methodology would be used instead of the current net density calculation method. Staff recommends, again, not advancing this proposal in the 2013 docket, but instead supports adding this to the list of items to be considered in the 2015 comprehensive plan amendment project, much longer term approach. The Kinder Ace LLC, Michael Reed and Associates docket request is a request to change the development code for the office zone properties to allow for the building of hardware and or garden stores in office owned areas. Staff recommends, again, not advancing this proposal in the 2013 docket. This request is specifically tied to a building site that was heavily constrained by critical areas, part of which is currently owned by the city. The community scale operations that are included in this docket request are outside the intent of the office zoned property. And lastly, the City of Sammamish Public Works Department has requested a transportation level of service proposal. That proposal is to develop and consider changes to the adopted transportation level of service. This, in turn, would allow modifications to the Transportation Improvement Project list, otherwise known as the TIP list. Staff does recommend advancing this proposal in the 2013 docket. This would be consistent with previous council direction and would allow modifications to the TIP list and also would allow us to later fold these into the transportation element of the 2015 comprehensive plan rewrite. So the next steps basically are that this evening we've outlined the four proposals with the staff recommendations, but no action is required. On December 4th, we would ask to receive council direction on which items are to be included, and we will discuss that with council on December 4th.
So if you just basically take this memo with you, and then they'll let us know before December 4th meeting if you have any specific questions, so we'll be prepared to address them, and that is the night that, again, tonight we're not asking for any action, and tonight I'm not prepared to have an in-depth discussion, mm-hmm. but we need to present to you, and we come back and have a more discussion on December 4th.
Are we likely to receive any further requests, or are we closed off at this point?
The process is closed. There was a period of time. People had to be mm-hmm. submitted per our municipal code, and that already expires, okay. So this is the process.
I thought that's what I saw earlier. Yeah. Okay.
With that concludes that part of the city manager's report. I have one more item that I'd like to quickly go through. I apologize taking for your time, but you need to give me a little slack here. I haven't given you detailed city manager report for quite some time, so be patient with me. next week, or next council meeting will be December 4th. You are going to see many contracts in the consent calendar. And that's the meeting. I won't be here. I don't want you to feel like the deputy city manager is out there and spending spree. It's all of those contract items are already part of the budget. We can't wait till the first of the year to start sweeping the streets and cleaning the catch basins. So we get ready for those things and we get those contracts lined up as soon as you approve the budget. It's the standard process that we go through. So I just want you to be aware of that. All those items, again, discussed in the budget, it's just the standard consent calendar items. We do that after budget is approved every time. We're adding one more item per council's request on the resolution for the community center project. The ballots will be, votes will be validated on the November 27. So certified on November 27, and then we'll bring the council resolution before you. And also, I want you to know that the next two council meetings that I won't be here, I'll be taking some time off. It will be a working vacation. I'll be taking the operating agreement that I'll be working on that one. I'll be also working on the economic development project scope of work services. So it'll be some vacation, some time off. I'm so looking forward to it. Not that I don't enjoy the council meetings, but I'll be thinking about you on December 4th.
Where are you going?
I'll be visiting my mother.
How nice.
Oh, that's sweet. Okay.
With that concludes the city manager's report.
Okay, thank you. And that brings us to the point where we talk about if we have an executive session. I believe we do not. So given that, the chair will may entertain a motion for adjournment.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say nay. 6-0, we adjourn. Thank you.